Overcoming, I would like to welcome Jenny Hrbacek. She is the author of Cancer Free, Are You Sure? She is also an RN and a breast cancer survivor, and she is here to tell you her story. So if y'all are ready, go ahead.
Thank you so much, Carrie. We've been emailing back and forth, and she said, when can you come? And anyway, we worked out a date that worked great. So I'm so glad to be here and to see all of you guys. I'm going to tell you some information on cancer. When you think about cancer, you think it's kind of bad information, but I'm going to tell you some really good information because I want to change the way you think about cancer. I want to change the way when we think about cancer, people think chemo, surgery, radiation, death, dying, you know, loss of body parts, loss of hair. Well, what if that didn't have to be? What if there's another way? Do you know that one out of two people, or one out of two men specifically, will get a cancer diagnosis in their lifetime? One out of 2.5 women will get a cancer diagnosis in their lifetime. So if I look out here on this room and there's 35 people here, there's 15 or 16 people in this room that have cancer and don't even know it yet. It's become pandemic. It's not something we can stick our head in the sand and not worry about anymore. So what I want to tell you is one thing I discovered was I started thinking about how we diagnose cancer. And when my nursing magazine came last month, on the cover was a picture of a gene. And do you know we can map the human genome? We can look at the chromosomes, the DNA, the telomeres. We can even take a seed, and we can take the DNA from another species, inject it into the seed, keep the DNA intact, and it will actually grow. But yet, we can't find cancer until it's grown large enough to show up on an imaging test. Does that make any sense to anyone? I started to question that. I thought, really? We can do this, but we can't find cancer until we get it big enough to take a picture of. So I want to tell you my story briefly. In 2009, I was diagnosed with breast cancer, and I was told it was caught very early. I had a 1.9 centimeter tumor. And what I want to tell you is that I went to the doctor every year for a physical. Every year I went, my CBC was fine. You know, my red blood cells, my white blood cells, my hemoglobin, my hematocrit, my cholesterol, my blood sugar, everything was fine. But yet, one day, I get this cancer diagnosis, and I felt fine. I thought I was a perfectly healthy 47-year-old. I did not know I had any problem. So just because you're not sick or you know, don't have anything going on doesn't mean you don't have cancer. Anyway, what I did was I asked a lot of questions, and I think I made a lot of my doctors irritated. One of them actually said to me, why do you ask so many questions? Why don't you just do what I tell you to do? That's what my other patients do. And at that point, one of the little light bulbs went on, and I thought, you mean people just come in here and do this without asking questions? It made no sense to me. So if anyone in here has ever had cancer, you know the first thing you ask is, how bad is it? Is it stage 0, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4? You want to know that because that is related to outcomes, correct? Because we know the earlier we find it, the better the outcomes are. And so I asked that question. Mine was stage 1, but when they found a little 2.4 millimeter seed in one lymph node, it became stage 2A after surgery. But size-wise, it was a stage 1. But I asked another question. I took it one step further, and I said, how long have I had this cancer? Because I didn't understand why I was at the doctor 6 months ago, and I was fine. I didn't have any problem. And the year before, and the year before, and the year before. And he said, oh, you've had this at least 7 or 8 years, maybe 10 to 12 years. And I thought, my goodness. And I didn't know what to do with that information. All I knew was that I wanted the cancer out, and I wanted it out as fast as I could get it out by the first person who would take it out. So when you get that diagnosis, if you're at an allopathic physician's office, all of a sudden they start handing you little lab slips, pieces of paper, to go for a nuclear heart scan, to go for an EKG, to go for blood works, to go for just test after test after test. And to see this, interview this doctor, interview this surgeon, interview this oncologist. And so I was on this rampage of all these appointments. These are more appointments than I ever wanted, than anyone should ever have their entire lifetime that I had in this 1 year. But anyway, within 2 weeks of my diagnosis, I had somebody that was willing to take out the cancer because I thought that by getting rid of that tumor, I would never have to deal with breast cancer again. And I said that over and over and over and over to every physician that I spoke to, every nurse. No one ever corrected me because I was wrong. I was dead wrong. All I did was keep the cancer from coming back in the tissue that went in the trash can. And all I did was keep the cancer from coming back in the tissue that went into the trash can by having a mastectomy. I did nothing to keep myself from ever having breast cancer again. So, and I'll talk more about that in a minute. Anyway, I had 4 infusions of chemotherapy, which was not a very good thing. And then I realized that I was getting the attack and kill approach, not the support and heal approach. In fact, this is not the snack machine that was in the infusion room where I had the chemotherapy, but it's one very similar. And I actually asked my oncologist, I said, you know, these people are willingly driving up in their car. They're getting out of the car. They're walking in here. They're signing in. They're coming into this full-dose chemotherapy infusion suite. They're sitting down. They're letting someone freely, without any hesitation, open a line and put very toxic chemotherapy into their blood. And so these people obviously want to live. I know they want to live, or they wouldn't be going through this. And this is what the snack machine in your infusion room looks like. And he actually told me, my dear, I am not in charge of the snack machine. So you have to be you have to look care out for yourself. And by being here at this institute, you have someone who is looking out for you. So I applaud you because you are much better off than I was. So I finished my therapy. And this is where I want to address that I said that all I did was keep the cancer from coming back in the tissue that they removed. I decided after I was done with this that I just felt like somebody wasn't telling me the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. You know how you just have a feeling in the back of your mind that there's more. So I went to a breast cancer support group, and it happened to be the very first time this group had met. They had a huge turnout, and for this meeting there was no speaker. Everyone just went around and introduced themselves, told what kind of cancer they had, told about their therapy. As the evening went on, I got more and more depressed. I'd come to this support group for what?
Support.
Exactly. But I wasn't getting support because what I realized is almost every woman in the room had the same type of breast cancer I did. I had estrogen, progesterone positive, HER negative. There's that kind, and then there's the triple negative. Almost everyone had the EP positive cancer. But half of these women had a recurrence, or they were going through a recurrence. They were told they were cancer-free, and the cancer came back. And I thought, what is going on here? And I looked over, I actually remember looking over my shoulder and thinking, do I have a target on my back or what? And the thing that made me sad was these ladies, and there were a couple of men, were actually excited to have their doctors and excited to have this treatment and excited that they were having a wonderful doctor taking such good care of them. But yet they couldn't swallow because they had sores in their throat and they were bald. And I'm telling you, I don't even like the color pink. I very rarely will put on pink because they have ruined this color for me. These ladies had on, they had pink scarves with rhinestones, pink caps, pink mugs, pink t-shirts, pink bags, pink comb and ribbons everywhere. And I just thought, and you guys are satisfied. These women were completely satisfied with what they were getting. And I thought, I'm not satisfied. I'm too crazy. I got to get out of here. So I decided that I was not going to be a statistic. Chemo, surgery, and radiation are not a cure, but they're a treatment. And you know, if you've ever been diagnosed with cancer, you go to the doctor, a regular doctor, and you want them to cure you. You want them to make the problem go away. And the way the chemotherapy and the surgery and the radiation are presented is that they are a cure. They don't say the word cure, but they say, this is what you're going to do. And they just start passing out orders and slips and make this appointment. We'll see you here. We'll do that. But it's just a treatment. It is not a cure. If it was a cure, it would be in the newspaper, right? If chemotherapy and surgery and radiation were the cure to cancer, we wouldn't have a cancer problem. Does everyone agree with that? So please don't be deceived. And it's so hard to get past this myth that most of Americans believe. I say cancer, you say chemo, surgery, and radiation. If I say burger, you say fries, right? If I say fries, you say ketchup. What I want you to do is I want you to say, when I say cancer, I want you to say, not chemo, surgery, and radiation, I want you to say opportunity to heal, toxicity, deficiency. Let's stop this. It's an early warning sign, because if you use the tests I'm going to tell you about, you can find it so much earlier that you can do things on your own. You can work with physicians here, like at the Kotsanis Institute, and you can stop it. You can absolutely stop it. I believe that 100%. So what I ended up doing was I thought, okay, I've got to get out of this support group. It's not supportive. So I left Houston, and I drove to Dallas, and I met with a man named Dr. Ray Hammond. He's in Rowlett. And this was years ago, back in, I guess it was probably 2010 by then. I said, you know, hi, I want to build up my immune system. And he said, oh, okay. And I said, he said, why? And I said, because I had cancer, and I probably had on a really bad wig. And he said, well, let's make sure you're cancer-free first. And I said, oh, no worries, I'm cancer-free. And he said, well, how do you know? I said, well, because I have clean surgical margins, which is what the doctors try and get, and I had a clean PET scan. So I don't have cancer. And he goes, can you just humor me? I need you to do this test because we can't build up an immune system if we need to know what we're starting with. So I thought, what is he talking about? So anyway, the test that I got was an RGCC onco count. He was looking for something called circulating tumor cells, which is something I had never heard of before. I had been through almost a year of therapy in Houston, some of their finest institutions, and I'm not even going to name where I went, but you can only guess. No one ever said anything about circulating tumor cells. So when you hear about someone who had colon cancer, and they go in and they remove the tumor in the colon, clean surgical margins, and they send them back out, and they're going back to their life, they're playing golf, they're, you know, doing whatever they do. And then a few years later or months later, you hear that so-and-so's colon cancer is back, but now it's in the liver. This is how this happens. These circulating tumor cells. I have a little graphic I want to show you. Up here on the top in the blue, that is the, what if my pointer works? Yeah, right here in the purpley blue there. That is a cancer cell. And you see these little blood vessels here that go into the tumor. There is no way you have a cancer cell that does not have, that doesn't have this feeding for it. You can't take something that's cancer cells are living tissue. They cannot live in the body completely isolated from the rest of the body. At some way, some point, they have to be getting nutrition. Once a little tumor starts and enough cells clump together, and it gets to be over about 2 millimeters, it will start sprouting these little blood vessels. And you see how the blood goes in, but also, guess what happens? Cancer cells are shed from the tumor into the bloodstream. And so they're circulating. They're circulating in your blood. They will test you for this at a standard allopathic physician. They're going to give you a test called Cell Search. Cell Search will only find cancer. It will only find the circulating tumor cells if you have metastatic disease. You have to have so many cells circulating, it has to have spread to another organ before their test will pick it up. So I tell people, they'll tell me, oh, I have 0 circulating tumor cells. And I'm like, how do you know? Well, I had a test, my doctor ordered it. People don't even know the name of the test, but I'm telling you, for you to know, tell your friends, tell everyone you know, if they have a circulating tumor cell test from Cell Search, it is late diagnostic. If you get a positive on that test, you have a big, big problem. And, you know, it's a great test if you want to find out if someone has metastatic disease, but why wait that long? Anyway, so I did the test, sent my blood off. I'm still standing here insisting that I'm cancer-free, because I've been through torture for the last year, and I can't imagine that I'm not cancer-free after I did all the stuff that I did. I know my aunt sitting up here in the front, she came to stay for me. She had to leave. I was so cranky. I had 4 drains coming out. I don't know, they're called Jackson-Perret. You squeeze them, and it's horrible. It's horrible. You don't want to talk. Your whole life is turned upside down. You don't even know what you want to do. I was probably not a very good patient. Anyway, she will attest to that. So 8 months after surgery, I get this report that I have the highest number. My test came back, and I won the award. I had more cancer cells circulating in my blood than anyone else who had ever walked through Dr. Hammond's doors. And to show you that, I had 14.2 circulating tumor cells per 7.5 cc's of my blood. Do you guys see this little syringe here? Okay, so if you took all of my blood and lined it up in this little syringe, I would have 1 cancer cell in every syringe. Because this is only half a cc, or that's a lot of cancer. That's how the cancer gets to other parts of your body, because those circulating stem cells are the ones that have the DNA and are able to start producing more circulating cancer cells and produce more tumor. But no one ever mentioned this to me. And I think that's why the doctors say, oh, we better give you some chemotherapy just in case, because they know about these circulating tumor cells, but they don't tell you. Anyway, so while I'm getting this report that I have this 14.2, this large amount of cancer cells, and I'm looking at all these other ladies who have had a recurrence, so I'm thinking, you know, this is probably pretty factual. My allopathic physician in Houston has me on the Weight Watch and Wonder protocol. She's telling me, oh, we're just going to wait, and because my tumor markers, there's so many different cancer tests. The ones that your allopathic physician will test you for are just basic tumor markers that are approved by the FDA for your type of cancer. For breast cancer, it's a CA15-3 or a CA27-29. Well, those numbers were actually starting to go up. But since they couldn't find anything on a scan yet, she just says, oh, we'll just watch it. And when it gets bad enough, when we find it on a scan, we'll do more surgery, and we'll do more chemotherapy and maybe some radiation. So, but at this point, she was doing nothing. She was going to wait, watch, and I was going to wonder, did they get all the cancer? Anyway, so Dr. Hammond actually told me, he says, you know, this is really not good. He said, he didn't even feel comfortable giving me a naturopathic plan. He says, you really need to go back to your oncologist. He was like pushing me out the door. And I said, I can't go back there. I fired him. I said, he told me about a snack machine. He was not in charge of it. And I said, he wasn't in charge of me. So I can't go back there. And I have another one, and she's got me on this Weight Watch and Wonder protocol. So he sends me to a doctor here in Dallas, which I wish he had sent me to Dr. Kotsanis, but we didn't know him yet. So you guys are blessed that you know him. Anyway, so I went to a doctor here in Dallas, and he says, oh my goodness, you need to be back on chemotherapy. And I thought, why in the world would I go back to a therapy that I had failed, a therapy that failed me, that what didn't work? Because we do know now that chemotherapy actually causes cancer cells to mutate, and it causes the stem cells to be even stronger. So I love to, let me just give you a little example. Say if this water bottle is full of cancer cells, okay? And you give the chemotherapy, and the chemotherapy kills all of the cancer cells except one drop up here. Well, that one drop that's left behind, or that one cell, that's the very strongest of all the cells. So what do you think is going to grow back? A crop of stronger. And then they need a different chemotherapy to give you a stronger one, and it knocks back all but the very strongest. And then you grow back another crop. And that's how you hear people say, oh, the chemotherapy stopped working, or only worked on these tumors, but not these tumors. It has to work on all the tumors, because cancer cells mutate, because they're dividing rapidly, okay? And I'll talk about that more when I talk about some of the testing that we're doing. Sorry, this is what I did. I started doing intravenous vitamin C. I did poly-MVA. I've done that IV. I took curcumin. I had a whole long list of natural substances. I got a very low-sugar diet. I only ate green apples, berries, and cherries. And very little of any kind of grain or potato or starch that turned to sugar. Started sweating, which is huge. You have to detoxify. You cannot, I know cancer is a disease of toxicity and deficiency. So you're toxic by some reason. It can be mold, it can be stress, it can be electromagnetic things. There's so many ways that our cells get toxic. From maybe you're a farmer or you live near a big chemical plant, but our cells are toxic. So you've got to detoxify.
Well, I understand, but when you're using IV
vitamin C, mm-hmm. What is the poly-MVA? Poly-MVA also can be done IV or oral. It's alpha lipoic acid bound with palladium and the B vitamins, and it works to upcharge the cellular energy, because we know what cancer cells have: a low energy. They have a hard time producing ATP. They work really hard. ATP is like the measurement tool of which we measure energy. Anyway, so the good news is, I walked out of there. I said, I'm not going to do chemotherapy, and I can't believe now when I look back that I did that. I turned away, and I wish I had done it the first time. But anyway, in 3 months, I had my countdown from 14.2 to 5.5. 6 months later, I had it down to 2.9, which is amazing. So I love this test, because you can take this test, and you can find out if your therapy is working, even if you're doing chemotherapy. If you've done chemotherapy, at least get this test a few months later, or consider it, because you want to see if your count is down. If the count didn't go down, it may have killed some of the tumor on the scan, but it may have caused a rise in these circulating tumor cells.
So tell us what the test is again.
Oh, I'm going to get to it in just a few minutes. Yeah. I'm just still kind of telling y'all my story. Okay, so my house became like the hotline because I'm trying to tell these ladies at this support group that, ladies, you don't have to have a recurrence. We can find a recurrence coming early. You know, or we could, you could have found this cancer years before you ever had this lump or bump, because the test that I had will find it when it's about 2 million cells. Anyway, so I was spending so much time on the phone, and I thought, I can't do this. My husband was getting cranky. It'd be dinner time, the phone would ring, and I have a hard time telling someone no if someone needs help. I would know when my phone rang and I didn't recognize the number. It was probably a 3 or 4 hour commitment to talk to someone, because you can't just tell them, go do this. They won't let go of you. That people were just leeching all over me. So I thought, I've got to learn more, and I've got to get out of the situation I've created, but I've still got to help people. So anyway, I got on the internet like we all do, which I should have got on the internet a year earlier before I did the chemo and the surgery. But now I'm on the internet. So I find Best Answer for Cancer, which is a great foundation. Dr. Kotsanis and Beverly are very active in that. And they actually sponsor the International Organization of Integrative Oncology Physicians Conference every year. Did you know there are a group of like 500 integrative oncologists around the world that meet? These guys are not the American Academy of Medicine people. These are integrative oncology people that are working to heal the body, to knock back the cancer, and instead of just poisoning, they're using the support and heal approach, not just the attack and kill approach. So what happened was, I went to, well, let me go back to this. I talked to Annie Brandt, who is the founder of this foundation, and she said, oh, you know what, our conference is in 2 weeks. And I said, well, can I help you? Is there some way I can come? And she goes, oh, well, we would love for you to volunteer a few hours. So I paid the admission, I got a hotel room, and I went. When I get there, I didn't realize that this was a physician's conference. I thought it was the Best Answer for Cancer. It looked very very mainstream, very casual for the normal people. But when I got there, they were all physicians. And I started looking around, and Dr. So-and-so from Japan, Dr. So-and-so from Canada, this one from Switzerland. And I thought, oh my goodness, they're going to wonder what I'm doing here. Anyway, so I looked down at my badge and it said Jenny Hrbacek, RN. And I decided, I know, they're going to think that I work for one of them. So I'll just blend in. So I blended, and I've been blending for 3 years now, and now I speak at their event. Anyway, so the way we diagnose cancer right now, in 2015, and we have for many, many years, and it has not changed, the standard of care in this country is for you to have a PET scan or a biopsy. Okay, so a PET scan is what? Anybody know? Radioactive glucose. And a biopsy is they just stick a needle into the tumor to see, you know, to check the cells to make sure it's just not some sort of other growth. The bad thing about this is, remember when I said before, you can have a tumor grow for 7 to 12 years before it will be big enough to show up on a PET scan. That's a very long time. That is a lot of wasted time. So here we go. I have a slide on this. And what I want you to know is that a clean or negative PET scan does not mean you don't have cancer. It just means there were not enough of the cells to pick up on the radioactive glucose. Here I have I may have a slide on this in a few minutes, but these are two visual aids that I have. They're just tennis balls with little pins in them. This is a normal cell with insulin receptors. And what happens when you eat some oatmeal or a cupcake, you have sugar and it binds to these little insulin receptors, which lets the sugar go into the cell for energy, right? This is a cancer cell. A cancer cell has 15, 16, 17 times the insulin receptors of a regular cell. So that's how the PET scan works. They give you the radioactive glucose. It circulates through the blood. These cells light up because the sugar, the glucose gets all over these. So that's the picture. But you have to have billions of these, billions in one spot for it to light up. So these circulating cells in the blood, they're not going to light up. So you have to be very, very wise and know that just because you have a clean PET scan, that doesn't mean you don't have a cancer problem. Let's see, and this is just a slide that's back in 2009, we knew that ovarian cancer can hide out for years before it will ever be big enough to show up on a scan. And this is pretty much for all cancers. I want to tell you about my friend Sammy Rea, because he was a victim of this system. 3 years ago, he went and had a PET scan. lit up positive for pancreatic cancer. So they said, okay, Sammy, we need to do a biopsy. So then they did a biopsy, and the biopsy was negative because, you know what? Tumors are not made of 100% cancer cells. It's a very small amount of a tumor is actually cancer cells. So they said, hey, you're fine. So he went back to his life. The next year, he went for his checkup. His doctor said, okay, let's do another PET scan. Guess what? Lights up again. They said, okay, let's do another biopsy. So that he goes back to the hospital. They numb him. They stick another needle into his pancreas, do another biopsy. Guess what? It comes back negative. So they say, oh, you're fine. Sammy he's now gone home to be with the Lord, but his wife is an amazing Italian cook. She makes great Italian cream cake, wedding cakes, soups, pasta. So he was eating a diet that really was probably not the best for a cancer patient, but he was told he didn't have cancer, right? So last year he went back again. They said, okay, let's do another PET scan. It lights up again. They do a biopsy, and this time they get some cancer cells. And now they tell him it's positive. Sammy was gone in 6 months. And if he had had the information that I'm telling you about here today, I truly believe he would be here today because he had valuable, valuable time wasted while he played this little game of PET scan biopsy. And so I do want to say this. Looking for a lump or bump is not the same as prevention. I call it trolling for business. So if you go and you have a mammogram and you have some little spot, they're looking for business. They even offer them $50, sometimes free, come in and get your mammogram. But they are trolling for business because you then qualify for their therapy. And then if you get a negative mammogram, which we know that they're showing now that mammograms, so many women have dense breast tissue. 50% of women, a mammogram won't even show a cancer if it's even there to begin with. Plus, it's ionizing radiation, which causes cancer, and the pressure can also burst and spread cells. It's a very, very dangerous test to have. And if you get a negative on it, you think you're fine. You think you have no cancer because it gives you a false sense of security. So what cancer is, it is deficiency and toxicity. Any way you look at it, any doctor you talk to, they will all tell you. I had the honor of having afternoon tea with Charlotte Gerson. I don't know if anyone heard of the Gerson Institute. Anyway, that was just a thrill. And she says, my dear, cancer is a disease of toxicity and deficiency. And I thought, can I quote you on that, Charlotte? And anyway, but all the doctors say that. But our cells are deficient or they're toxic, and there's so many different ways that can happen. I have a little chart in my book. I go over how each of these things relate, lifestyle, gene mutations, microbes, inflammation, acidity, decreased cellular energy, decreased oxygen to the cell, chemicals, synthetic hormones, processed food, sugar, and stress. There's not one thing. People will tell me, I got into this and this caused cancer. I don't believe it. Cancer is a culmination of things. You have to have your terrain has to be able to accept the cancer. You can get into something, but if you've got a stressful, you add two or three of these things together and you have a recipe for a big problem. If you're going through a stressful event, and you get in and you stop exercising and you eat a lot of fast food, you're very acidic. You know, even if you just have a few cancer cells, those things can just take off like fire at a time like that. So it's so important that we look at the whole body as a picture. So the status quo is not working, and because we have more Americans die every 18 months than in all the wars this nation has ever fought. And that's a terrible statistic. And we're spending more money, and cancer is still killing people. I always want to talk about sugar because I figure that, well, there's my little tennis balls, but I figure that when the American Cancer Society wages a war on sugar, or Susan G. Komen wages a war on sugar, I will know then that they really, really want to beat cancer. Because I have a bag of potato chips at home. It's a Lay's potato chips, and it has the big pink breast cancer ribbon on it. And I keep telling my husband, because he likes to eat, don't eat those chips. Because he's always like, why are these chips in the bathroom? I mean, in the closet. I'm like, because it's my bag of bad food that I show when I go talk. And that bag of chips is like 6 years old, but don't eat it. Because I'm showing that just because there's a pink ribbon on something doesn't mean that it's good for you. And once again, what do those potato chips do? They break down to sugar. These cancer cells are going to absorb that. And it's it's not a healing food. And high fructose corn syrup, I'm not even really going to go much into this, but it is really bad, guys, and it's in almost every packaged food that you buy. Your body can't even get the glucose. It has to go to the liver and be broken down. It's just a really, really bad thing, and it causes what? Let's look at this. Fuel for cancer cells, increases their metabolism. And yes, again, this is my quote. I believe that when the American Cancer Society wages a war on sugar, they're serious about beating cancer. This is me at a major cancer hospital in Houston, Texas. And you can guess where I'm at. I will not tell you. But that's in the surgical waiting room. And there's a big bowl of candy there. Okay, so when I told y'all that I went to that conference, for the IOICP, they had a huge banquet room. It was actually at a hotel where they had all of these different vendors. And I thought, wow, this is kind of cool. But I walked in, and they had people standing at the door to keep anyone from the public from walking in this room, because it was just for the physicians. These were vendors that were there not to talk to the public, but to talk to the physicians. So I'm in there, I didn't know I was going to find out anything about cancer testing. I just walked up to one of the tables, and it was the first table I walked up to was a lady named Rebecca Davis with Oncoblot. And I said, hi, how are you? Because remember, I'm being aggressive because I don't want them to ask me what I'm doing there, because I don't have a practice. I don't treat patients. I don't sell anything. I'm just there to find out what the heck is going on. And she goes, oh, well, we have a test. We can find cancer years before it would show up on a mammogram, PET scan, PSA, or biopsy. And I said, really? And you remember, I've got in the back of my head that I've had cancer for 7 to 8 years before I was diagnosed. And I said, man, can I have your information? So I got my little bag, and I put it in there, and I go to the next booth, and I walked up, and I said, hi, so what do you do? It was Red Drop. And a guy named Rob there, and he said, hey, no, I'm sorry, Rich. He said, oh, we've got a test. We test for thymidine kinase. It shows when high thymidine kinase level is cells that are replicating fast. And he said, we can detect cancer years before a mammogram, PET scan, PSA, or biopsy. And I said, really? I'm like, man, can I have your information? So I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, I just wanted to call my friends and say, you can't believe what I'm finding out here. I didn't have to have cancer. I didn't have to have all the surgery. I didn't have to have a lump or bump. These people could have found it years before. So then I'm walking around, and I'm thinking, good Lord. I talk to the Lord a lot. I'm like, please don't let anybody else tell me here that they can find cancer years before a mammogram, PET scan, PSA, or biopsy. So I walk around, and I see this little old gentleman there. His name's Emil Shandel. And I walk up to him, and he looked harmless, and nobody was talking to him. And I walked up, and I said, so, hey, what do you do? And he said, oh, I have a test called the CA profile. I can find cancer years before a mammogram, PET scan, PSA, or biopsy. And I just thought, he just knocked the wind out of me, because I thought, how dare they? How dare they? I am a normal person. I am not a brilliant person. But if I can find this information, all of these doctors that I saw, do they not have a duty to do better than what they're doing? You know, and I understand that they do want to help people, but when you're messing with people's lives, I think you do have a duty to keep up with what's going on. So anyway, I sat and visited with him there for quite a while, because he could really talk. And when I told him my story, he felt kind of bad for me. And so I got his information, and I already knew that RGCC was at the conference. And I thought, well, this is four companies in this room that can find cancer years before the PET scan and the biopsy. And then I got to thinking, why isn't the public mobbing this place? Well, because they have a couple of people standing at the door keeping people out, because, you know, but I thought if these people out here in this huge hotel conference center knew the information that was in here, they should push those two ladies over and get in here. This is amazing. So really, by now, my phone is going haywire, because I know a lot of people with cancer, and I've watched a lot of people die. And now I have even more information other than just the circulating tumor cell and the RGCC test. So I decided I have to write a book, because I can't talk to all these people. And I have a lot of good friends, and friendships take a lot of work. And I'm fine with that in that category. I don't need all these people, because it was like dragging me down. So anyway, I started writing this book, because I still want to help people, but there's more of them than there are of me. So I have a book, and I have 10 tests in it that will find cancer, detect cancer years before a mammogram, PET scan, PSA, or biopsy. And what I do is I tell you the summary of the test. I tell you exactly, and actually I use these little, there we go. I use these little icons because I want it to be user-friendly because I can't keep repeating. I couldn't return all the phone calls that I had. And I thought, I've got to help people, but I can't return all these phone calls. There's not enough hours in the day. So I tell you the summary and explanation. I tell you how to get the test. I show you what the test is going to look like when the result comes back. I tell you how the results are interpreted. I tell you how accurate the test is, because all of this is well documented. I tell you how much it costs, how long it's going to take, because you know when you get a test, you want to know when is the result coming back. I tell you the benefits, the limitations, the confidentiality, and I tell you my thoughts on it. So I want to go over some of the tests that are in the book, and there's a lot, so I'd be here all day if I went through each one. That's why I wrote it, to try and help people. So the first test is that CA profile that I was talking about. That test is an amazing test. It's Dr. Shandall. One of the many, it's a test that's made up of smaller tests. One of them is the PHI, it's a motility factor. If that is high, that's a high indicator of cancer. He tests your HCG hormones, and he knows how to read this. It's a wonderful test. It's $300 or $400. The next one is the Oncoblot. Do you know that cancer cells shed something called the ENOX2 protein? Only cancer cells put off the ENOX2 protein. So if you have a positive ENOX2 protein in your blood, you have cancer. And for them to be able to pick this up, I have a slide later I'll show you, you have to have about 2 million cells, about the size of a pen. If we put a little piece of ink on my finger, about just that big, way before the PET scan or the biopsy would even come into play. And they can even tell you the site of the cancer, if it's one of the 27 major origins of cancer. Red drop, this is a thymidine kinase test. That test is also, thymidine kinase is put out by cancer cells, and it will show if you have some cells that are replicating fast. If that level's high, it's just kind of a little heads up that maybe something's going on, you need to look further. Nagalase is a test that one's $85, $85, $89, depending on which lab you use. Nagalase is put out by viruses and cancer cells. So if you don't have any viral load, any kind of bad virus going on, and you have a high nagalase level, that's an indicator that you have cancer. What nagalase does is it's produced by viruses and produced by cancer cells, and it suppresses the macrophages of your immune system, which are the cells that go up and what gobble the bad guys. So I had someone I was working with last month that had a high nagalase level. It turned out she had ovarian cancer. We found it with the Oncoblot, found it very, very early. She had her ovaries removed, and she's right now waiting on her circulating tumor cell test to see if there were any cells that had shed, and she's going to do some oxidative therapies, and will probably live long and prosper, as they would say in Star Trek. So that's the kind of story I like to hear about. Cologuard, that's a test that you may have seen some in magazines. They're doing a pretty big national campaign. That one is paid for by insurance a lot of times and Medicaid. They're looking at stool, and it's a DNA test plus an occult blood test. But if you don't get that approved and you're worried about colon cancer, just go on Amazon and order an occult blood stool test. It's about $29, $30. Use the toilet. Drop in the little test strip. If it turns, then you know there's occult blood there, which means hidden blood that you can't see, which is a really early indicator of colon cancer. If that's all you can afford, then I've got a test in there that's going to cost you that. There's also a test where you can send use the supplies from the art store. You need some acetone and a coffee filter. You can send your urine over to the Philippines, and they will check you and tell you if you have a high rate of whatever your rate of cancer might be. And I love that test. So some people don't have a lot of money, but just if you look at my book, no matter what your budget is, there's no reason not to check to see if you don't have some cancer going on. RGCC OncoCount, that's the one I did. I sent to Europe. And I will tell you, I also did the circulating tumor cell count with Cell Search that's here in the U.S., and that one came back zero. So but yet my tumor markers are elevated, and my oncologist says, oh, Jenny, you don't have cancer. Don't worry about it. Eat cupcakes, exercise, take a multivitamin, get out of here. You're fine. And I said, well, wait a minute, because, you know, I'm going to ask questions. I said, so what was my CTC with Cell Search when I had the original tumor. She said, oh, we don't check it on anyone when they first come in with cancer. And I said, why? And she said, because it won't show cancer until it's metastasized to another organ. And I said, oh. I said, so you're telling me that it was zero when I had a known tumor, and now you're telling me it's zero, and you're sure I don't have cancer. But before I did have cancer, y'all see, that didn't make any sense to me. I said, and she just looked at me with this blank look on her face. And that's when she told me to eat the cupcake and get out of there. Anyway, I think I've made a lot of people mad. Okay, so good things are happening. I just want to give you updates. This test, OncoBlot, they're actually going through clinical trials right now to try and get approved. In fact, I'm having a little lunch with them here in a little while. Where it says 1.2 millimeters, that's the size of a pinhead. 2 million cells, they can find cancer. This test is a little expensive. It's $850. I don't recommend it for people who've already had cancer because you already know you had cancer. Then you want to use some of these other tools. You want to look at your nagalase level. You want to look at some other things. You want to look at your circulating tumor cell or I'm sure Dr. Kotsanis, there's so much information in this area that is not being used by standard allopathic oncologists. So this is exciting. I would love to see this get approved. I wanted to give an update on RGCC because they're growing by leaps and bounds. They've got 4 branches now in the USA, Canada, Germany, and Greece. I just spoke with them 2 days ago. They have almost 500 physicians now in the USA that you can order this test through. And this can get really complicated. With this test, you do need a physician. They can give you an onco count. And people say to me, Jenny, doesn't everybody have cancer cells? And I say, yes, everyone makes cancer cells every day. But you should not be able to bring them, pull them from your blood and grow them ex vivo in a petri dish in a lab. You should not be able to do that. Your immune system should kill them. Dr. Yannis Papacentori owns a patent where he can actually take those cancer cells that he gets from your blood sample that's sent over, and he can exponentially reproduce them and have millions and billions of cells within 24 hours. And then he uses those cells to test for other things. And they offer all sorts of different things, chemo-SNP, pharma-SNP, oncostat. They do extract testing. For me, the main thing for this test is that count, just to make sure that if you've done therapy, that your therapy is working, or to see a recurrence coming early, or potentially to find cancer years before you would ever have a lump or bump. Then I took it a step further because I just kind of got on this path and I couldn't really get off the road. Once I got going, and I got to thinking, well, if we can find cancer before you ever get a lump or bump, maybe there's things we can test for before we would even have that development. So right here, like these top two tests, a galactin-3 and a C-reactive protein, those are going to tell you your inflammatory factor. Do y'all remember my slide before when I had all the different sources of cancer? One was inflammation. Cancer loves an inflammatory environment. So check when you just go to your regular doctor, your relatives, tell them, say, hey, can you draw a C-reactive protein or can you draw a galactin-3 level? And make sure that's low. And if it's not, there are lots of natural things you can do to get that down. Sorry, I meant to do my light. The hemoglobin A1C, that's going to tell you your blood sugar, what it's been for like the last 3 months. And remember my little tennis ball? You don't want to be running systemically high blood sugars. If you've got any cancer cells going, it's just not a good idea. A lymphocytic response analysis test. Let's say, I love the Gerson therapy, but let's say when you eat carrots, you don't notice anything is wrong with you, and they have a lot of carrot juice, but say you eat carrots, and it causes an internal lymphocytic rise, which means you're going to have inflammation, and that's going to be a distraction for your immune system. You need to know that, because that's going to hinder your therapy. You're not going to do as well. You need to switch from carrots to a different kind of vegetable. Use other vegetable juices. Or if you're eating almonds all day and almonds are causing a lymphocytic rise in your body and you just can't seem to get well, you're fatigued, you got to find out what these sources of inflammation are. Maybe you need to take a great digestive enzyme. Maybe you're missing something to break that down. But these things need to be dealt with. You can do a parasite or urine test because we know it's a fact that cancer patients have parasites. We all have parasites because, you know, we have microbes in our gut that make vitamins and hormones and help us to digest our food. But when you get an overgrowth, and we don't know whether cancers, you know, cancer patients get the parasites, or the parasites come and cause the cancer, but there's a relationship to fungus and microbes and cancer. So right here, that's a great test to get. And a viral screening. We know that a lot of these viruses are associated with different cancers. Electrodermal screening is great to do because if your body's not connected electronically, that's why we have a spinal cord. That's how it all works. You need to check that out. Hormones are huge. If you're not metabolizing your estrogen correctly, you can have a problem. And I have 19 different tests in the book that are functional that you can just look at getting if one of them rings true and you think I might have a problem with this. I wanted to highlight one of them, which is the C-reactive protein. It's just a simple blood test. This is just a few. There are over 200 diseases that are related to inflammation. And this is just a few of them. If you've got allergies, I can tell you your C-reactive protein is probably not down where you want it to be. If you've got arthritis, Alzheimer's, cancer, lupus, Hashimoto's, thyroiditis, all of these things, I could do 30 screens with diseases that are related to inflammation. So I just wanted to highlight in the book, I go over all this. And what causes inflammation? Bad fats, vegetable oil, canola oil, that salad that you didn't get here, but the salad you got somewhere else was probably made with a bad fat at a restaurant. It's better to ask. If I tell people, if you ask the waitress, what kind of oil is in this salad dressing and they don't know, just don't eat it. Because if it was olive oil, they would know. Food sensitivities cause inflammation, processed food, GMOs, chemicals, tissue toxicity. There's so many things that can cause that fire in the body. And I do have a little screen on GMOs. It's not natural for the body. And on here, we know that let me just show you this real quickly. 95% of soybeans are GMO, 95% of sugar beets, 93% of canola. And look at this corn. I believe it's even higher than that now. So when you're eating corn, you're getting the glyphosate residue because they spray the corn with the Roundup because it's been genetically modified so that the Roundup doesn't kill it because they're trying to kill the weeds, right? So when you get that corn, every time you eat corn and it's non-GMO, you're getting that residue in your stomach of the Roundup. So I tell people until they take that little triangle off the back of the Roundup container that says call the Poison Control Center if ingested, you really need to avoid a lot of this GMO corn because every time you eat it, you're inoculating your gut. You're killing your good gut flora. Does that make any sense? Okay. So what I want to do is this is my little mission statement here. Let's change how cancer is detected and create a world where it's possible to head off a formal diagnosis because we can. The information is there. The tests are there. We can do it. This is my little cartoon. Mr. Hopwood, we got it all. Great news. Isn't that terrible? It's just horrible. Because when you get cancer, remember I said hamburger, y'all said fries? I say fries, you say ketchup. I say cancer, everybody says surgery or chemo. We don't want this. This is old. We can do better. We can do better. And that's my mission, is to let the world know we can do better. If you're not watching this, it's The Truth About Cancer, The Global Quest. It's put on by Ty Bollinger. You can go onto my Facebook page, Jenny Hrbacek, and there's a link on there, and you can watch it. There's 9 episodes. Tonight will be the episode number 4. I was just in a little clip on episode number 3, and then Ty said I'm in episode number 5 again. But he has traveled the world doing interviews with over 131 people in clinics and people that are doing integrative care. So really, if you can tune into that, you can listen to it on your iPhone while you lay in bed and you go to bed at night. It does have video with it. It has often been said that the United States does not have a healthcare system, but we have a disease management system focused on expensive drugs and invasive surgeries. So what I would like to do through public awareness is ask that system to do more to promote health. I have a website now. It's called nolumperbump.com. And anyone that is willing, if you would go to my website and send me your story, because I think if through United Voices, if we get enough stories, I'll post them on there. I'll even put your picture. I want people to tell me. I was diagnosed with cancer, and I was told I'd had it for 8 years. I was told I had it for 10 years. Or if you've come and you've used one of these tests and you've been able to convert it back to negative or keep cancer at bay or see a recurrence coming early, I want to share those testimonies, and maybe we can get some attention around the world and change the way cancer is detected. There's a Proverbs 14:23 says, in all labor there is profit, but idle chatter leads to poverty. So y'all can come listen to me, but unless you do something, unless you spread the message, unless you take action, nothing will happen. So I want to thank you for coming and thank Gus and Beverly Kotsanis for inviting me. I'm happy to answer any questions.